saith the Lord. And he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live again. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that in that day we shall stand upon the earth. Now, and the skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold and not another. Though my reins be consumed within me, for you are nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in him. So cast thy cares upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my soul. He also is become my salvation. And he said unto them, why are you fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and rebuked the winds and the sea. And there was a great calm. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. For thus saith the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in quietness and in confidence shall be the strength. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world gives, give I unto you. So let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Grace be unto you and peace from him which is, and which was, and which is to come. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will receive you again unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. For I am in a betwixt two, having the desire to depart and to be which is and God shall wipe all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. There no wicked shall cease from trouble, and the weary shall be. You may go take your seats. We want to allow you to spend time with your family. fellowship with the family. Thank you for coming and sharing in this great, great celebration of life whom God himself has blessed. His son is not on our heart. God bless you.
Thank you. shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which remain shall be caught up together in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First off, I'd like to give my condolences also to this great Courts family. Thank you so much for selecting me to do the prayer this morning for you all. Brother Fred, I remember serving with him in the male chorus, and he was always sitting back there in the corner. And whenever we would come in, he would smile. He was so nice and peaceable. He was a humble man and had a sense of humor. And I just enjoyed being in his presence. But at this time, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Oh, precious and heavenly Father, God, as again we come to you, Lord. God, we just give you praise, honor, and glory. Lord, we just thank you for the life of Brother Fred Courts, God. We thank you for the quality of life that he lived and the quantity, Lord God. God, now we just thank you for this, the great Courts family, oh Heavenly Father. God, asking in the name of Jesus that today and every day afterward, Lord, that you will please continue to be with them, oh Heavenly Father God. God, help them to know that, God, that he's with you now and he's better off now than he ever has been and ever will be, Lord. God, I pray that the peace of God would pass, that passes all understanding, will guide our hearts and the minds, God, knowing that he's with you now. He's safe, Lord God. He's better off, Lord. And we just thank you so much for that. God, we just pray that in the passing days, you be with this family. We pray that your peace, God, will comfort them, Lord.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
God, that your peace will allow them to smile when they think about it, Lord.
Oh, yeah.
And that your peace will give them joy in their hearts, Lord. Just thinking about him, Lord. God, we just thank you now. We give you honor, praise, and glory. We ask these in all prayers in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
God is an awesome God, isn't he? At this time, we shall have a musical selection from the choir, after which we will have resolutions and acknowledgments by Ms. Wanda Williamson.
Thank you.
These cards were chosen by the family to be read. As some people journey through life, they leave footprints of kindness and love, courage and compassion, joy and faith. Even when they are gone, the trail they left behind continues to inspire us. Praying God will comfort and care for you while you celebrate the legacy that lives on with sympathy, caring, deal, and family. A dad leaves his mark in the world through the love he gives his children. The loss of a father is never easy, but what stays with you keeps him alive in your heart, and that's the loving memories of all you shared together. So sorry for your loss, love always, Tiny and Steve Long. With heartfelt sympathy and prayers. I never had the pleasure of meeting him. After working with Gerald for many years, I am sure he must have been an amazing man. I will be keeping you all in my thoughts and prayers during this difficult time. Drew McGovern. May God's promise of life everlasting bring peace, comfort, and healing to your soul. Rethinking of you. You have lost someone very special, someone who touches many hearts. And those hearts would touch many more. And in that way, your loved one will always remain a part of you, a part of everything. With sincere sympathy, Oscar and Brenda Red and family. With deepest sympathy, Jesus told them, "Everyone who has faith in me has eternal life." John 6:43-47. May you find comfort in God's promise and strength in his presence at this difficult time. Peace and blessings, First Baptist Church family, Hubbard Street, Reedsville. With deepest sympathy, gone from our sight, but never our memories. Gone from our touch, but never our hearts. Thinking of you and hoping your memories of special times bring you comfort. FedEx Club. May God comfort you. His eyes see each tear you cry. His ears hear your words of loss. His heart knows the pain you feel. And his arms hold you close, just as they do the one who has gone on to him. With sympathy and prayers, love, Reedsville Senior High School class of 1971. Our thoughts are with you. With heartfelt sympathy to you and your family as we remember a life so well known. Booker T. Washington High School class of 1969. Friends to comfort you, memories to strengthen you, love to bring you peace. Wishing you all these things in your time of sorrow. Frankie, we are sending our love of deepest sympathy to you and your family. Booker T. Washington High School, class of 1967. Church resolution. And before I get started, my daughter said, "Mom, you know, Mr. Fred was the first Uber driver in Rockingham County." When I went to work, got her up, she went back to bed when I left the house. But she called Granny. Mr. Fred took her to school over and over. The Jerusalem United Holy Church, Reidsville, North Carolina, has lost a jewel. Mr. Fred E. Kors Sr. Brother Fred Kors not only came to Sunday school and church service, but he brought his children and grandchildren, his wife, Mother Mildred Kors, Granny, with him. He influenced the lives of many other children as well as adults. Our beloved joined the Jerusalem Church, where he remained faithful and diligent servant of the church. With a deep love for his church family, he grew in the Lord and received salvation. He displayed his faithfulness to serving Christ through continuous study and prayer. Brother Fred sang with the male choir. With his rich baritone voice, and led, "This morning when I rose, I didn't have no doubt." He would say, "That was good, Brother Joe," who I'm told they talked every day, sometimes several times a day. Also attended the men's Sunday school class. He was a church steward, men's fellowship, and helped with our annual student. Whereas we celebrate the homegoing of our oldest member of Jerusalem United Holy Church, Brother Fred has joined the angel host of Jerusalem members who have gone on before him. He will be there waiting for us. We miss him, but we find some peace in knowing that his suffering is over. We can truly say that he fought a good fight. He kept the faith. Now he can receive his reward. Although we will miss him, we know that God knows best. We thank God for the many years Brother Fred Kors was a part of Jerusalem family. His death leaves a void. However, we thank God for his faithfulness and continuous contributions he made. Be it resolved that the Jerusalem Church family extend our deepest sympathy to the Kors and Moyer family. Be it further resolved that we continue to pray for each of you as you remember the good times you shared with Brother Fred. And lastly, be it resolved that a copy of this resolution be kept at the church and a copy given to the family. In his care, the Jerusalem United Holy Church, Bishop Mary E. Jackson, Pastor, Recording Secretary Wanda Williams. Amen.
Thank you, thank you.
Right before our soloists come to render a selection, I just wanted to say to the family, I feel cheated because I missed many of those great things that were told about him in the fellowship. However, I did get an opportunity to just share a little with him. I would see him out shopping for different, I guess, things. And so I would come over to Mr. Freeman and ask him, you got everything you need? I'm fine. And so I feel cheated a little bit, but nevertheless, I'm appreciative because you being here along with the family to support them kind of shows them, and not only that, I can see it in others, other members of the family whose life, you know, I've had the privilege of sharing a little time with as well. So I just wanted you to know that I really appreciate him, his finesse, his servanthood. And not only that, I remember one Sunday, I asked him, I said, Mr. Fred, I said, God has blessed you, and you're such a man of dignity and character. I said, do you mind saying something to the church? He said, what do you want me to say? I said, Mr. Freeman, you say what's in your heart to say, because I believe that you have something to say, the one who has lived as long as you have, and someone will be inspired. So he did say something. He did, and I appreciate that. At this time, we're going to have a selection by Miss Stephanie Watson, after which you shall hear the word of God coming from his former pastor, Bishop Elijah Williams. Also, he was a former president of the United Mormon Churches of America, prelate, rather, of the United Mormon Churches of America. So at this time, our Sister Watson is coming, and then sit in your tent doors and hear what the word of the Lord has to say to you through the man of God.
Bye. Bishop Mary Jackson and to all the ministers that are serving today, as well as other ministers that might be here, and all you and this very fine family that we're serving today. I thank God for the opportunity to speak on behalf of our friend and brother. You know, a eulogy is about a person. If you look up the word eulogy, it's, you know, a commendation to someone who lived. And so you got to almost know somebody to do a eulogy. I think that I know Brother Fred as well as most people, because when I came here in 1981, the church had a practice of asking members to feed the preacher and his family after church. Get my daughter back in. And our joy was to go to eat supper, such as the Miracle's food. And she could cook, and Brother Fred just sat and grinned and just said, "You want something else? You want something else?" And I just, you know, we just, well, I guess, you know, but down home we said we pigged out. Y'all don't say that. He was such an unassuming person, calm and quiet. But what I want to share with you today, and the family that asked me as well to do the eulogy, because you notice no tributes. Did you notice that? No, on the program, no tributes. I'm giving a tribute. When you get 101, your fear is gone. Nobody else around talk about you, kid being a kid and all that. I'm 86 and most, I haven't gotten 100 yet. And both of my bills are gone. So, but what I want to say is, what I want to say to all of us, especially to the family, is that Brother Fred had, and I get to the eulogy, but I was asked to do this. Brother Fred had the kind of work ethics that all of his sons and his daughter worked. Faithful workers, his grandchildren. There's something about us as family, as parents. Our children learn from us how to operate and function in life. And it's not so, you know, it's not what you tell them. It's what you do. People don't do what you do because you tell them, because you say a lot of stuff. But they watch you. I remember him working at the factory. And I think, you know, when I came here, it wasn't long after eating time. But he worked, and I remember the time he spent with his grandsons, grandchildren, picking them up from school, spending time with them. That's what you do. And I think the secret to his living 101 years old is this. I'm gonna give you some what I think, and it's not written in stone, and it's not something I can prove, but this is what I suspect. If you want to live a long time, you don't need to be in a whole lot of mess. I have never known Brother Fred to be in any kind of controversy. Have you? Anybody ever seen? I have never seen him arguing. He never, my pastor never came to me upset about anything. He was just Brother Fred. So he had no stress that killed us. We got a doctor in the house and he can help me out.
had a routine, and I have, and that's what I have learned. You need a routine.
Yes, right.
And you need to hold yourself accountable to that.
Yes.
What I mean by routine is, you know, if you do something to exercise or you do something, do it constantly. Don't just New Year's Day you start. And, things he did in a routine way, and it was inconsistent.
Yes.
It's almost like rehearsal or practice. You know, you do it all over and over again.
Yes.
And your body adjusts to that.
Yes.
I tell you what I do, and some people, I weigh myself at least 3 or 4 times a week. I'm gonna tell you why. So if I'm gaining, then I know I need to do something. I don't wait till I get so I'm scared to get on the scale. We need a routine. We're the nurse practitioner. All I'm saying is, and the thing about the church is this, the thing about the church is, now that's more family, but I'm gonna talk about the church too. What he was to the church is faithfulness. And I remember this, when we had the pandemic, the church closed, the pandemic closed everything. We all couldn't come to church. Church was locked, closed. Well, I don't know if the lock was closed. We had to have parking lot service.
Uh-huh.
We could come to church, but we couldn't come in.
Uh-huh.
Guess who was riding around the parking lot game in Jesus? That's right.
Amen.
He came and he sat in the Jeep and he listened to the pastor preach from a platform in the parking lot. And I'm gonna say this. When we asked him, tried to get him to be a deacon, asked him, inquired of him. He wasn't interested in being a deacon because Brother Fred didn't want to get involved. In other words, he wanted his quiet life and he didn't want to deal with these issues. It wasn't about accepting him. He was just that kind of person. And also, he served on the steward board where he went and helped to do that in a quiet way. After I got in the 80s, I'm in the 80s now. I'm 86, 87 in 2 months. I went to Brother Fred not too long ago, maybe about a few months ago, and I said to him, Brother Fred, because I'm old enough to ask somebody how old they are. You know, especially they're older than I am, a little bit older than I am. I said, Brother Fred, I said, how old are you? I said, we both are getting up there, how old are you? You know what he told me? I'm getting there. He just wanted to live one day at a time, doing the best he could, being helpful to whoever he could be helpful to. That was his life. He wasn't into all this, you know, accommodations and, you know, all the stuff that we do. He wasn't into that. Just wanted to be Brother Fred. So if you want to live a long time, be like Brother Fred. Now, I hope that you will indulge turn to me when I start talking, I'll let you know. The family told me to say that. So if you're going to tell me how long I preach, now you can take it away. I'm just honored to, and I said to the pastor, I appreciate you being understanding, you know, because sometimes your ministers are, you know, territorial, and you know, they want to be, but she's real open, and we're a team. You know, I have utmost respect for her as a pastor of this church. I'm not the pastor. I was a pastor. I was. Now let's and in this sermon that I'm going to do today, and hopefully it won't be too long because I'll take a lot of your time. What I'm going to do today is deal with something that all of us can relate to when it comes to someone passing away in our family. Because sometimes what's helpful is if you have knowledge of how to deal with it. And I think sometimes we fail to help people deal with that. And the scripture that I'm going to use will help us to deal with Brother Fred passing on to another life. And it comes from St. John, the 11th chapter. If those who are... St. John, the 11th chapter. The 21st through the 26th verses. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, Jesus will give you, I'm sorry, I know now that God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. And the one who believes in me will live, and even though they die, and whosoever lives and believeth in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is coming to the world. And I want to talk from the subject, believers never die. They live with Jesus. Believers never die. And you know, I want to say something else to the family and to you in talking to this family. Don't say to this family that they shouldn't grieve because Brother Fred lived 101 years old. It does not matter. Whether you live 10 years or 100 years, grief is grief. They don't want to come in and tell you, you're better off now than you know. No, don't do that. We love our loved ones. And we want to hurt for them, just like you would hurt if somebody died in their 20s. It makes no difference. This text about Lazarus being raised from the dead has much to say to the Christian community when it comes to our loss of a loved one. In this text, Lazarus and his family represent the church, the bereaved family. Lazarus' family, like the church family, was well acquainted with Jesus. They enjoyed spending time with him. As Christians, we constantly invite him into our homes, our churches, to visit with us. That is when we pray. We don't wait until we have trouble to call him. I say that again. We don't wait till we have trouble. Let me say this, even in your neighborhood where you have neighbors, speak to them before you have trouble. Amen. The way the world is now, who knows when we're going to have a great catastrophe. And if you don't speak to your neighbor, you don't know how to deal. You don't know how to deal with them when you need them.
That's right.
I walk in my community about every day, and I'm friendly with everybody because when storms come up, and I need to go on somebody's porch, I don't want them to be offended.
Right.
I started to say something else. I don't want them to be offended. And I have said to them, I said, if a storm come up, can I come on your boat? Oh, yes, sir, come on. They call me the walking preacher. Come on, you come on. What I'm saying to you today is, we don't need to just call on the Lord when we're in trouble. We need to be acquainted with him. You see what I'm saying? We need to be acquainted with the Lord so that he knows us and we know him. And when we call on him, not only when he come because we're in trouble, but he come just to be a friend to us, to cheer us up, to help us along the way. Jesus also is our friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. It does not matter that we love Jesus as much as it matters that he loves us. When Mary and Martha sent for Jesus, they said, Lord, he whom thou lovest is sick. Not he who loves you, he who we love, but the one that loves you. If God doesn't love us, then no other love matters.
Amen.
Could you imagine a world in which God didn't love us? Do you know the situation we were in when God loved us so much until he sent his son into the world to save us? We didn't deserve it, but God did. If we trust God, if we trust God with our lives, he will take care of us. This family has sent messages to God through prayer to bless and protect Brother Fred. And when he was sick, they prayed for his healing. I'm sure the family wanted Brother Fred to continue to live, even though he had already lived more than 100 years. But let's listen to the voice of Jesus, what Jesus said. Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Which means that Brother Fred really did not. He just transitioned. He just went from his home to a better home. Through Jesus, we come to understand more about death. Death from the beginning is tied to sin. The wages of sin is death. In his letter to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 15:55-57, Paul explains how we should view death differently. He said, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the gift, the strength of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. But what happened is, Jesus told Mary and Martha that your brother will live again. And when Martha said to Jesus, by now, after 4 days, he has an order. Jesus said, just tell me where you laid it. The raising of Lazarus from the dead was a sign to come to strengthen their belief and our belief in the power of God over life and death. Let this family take comfort in knowing that God is in control of Brother Courts, and Brother Courts is all right, and when I say all right, A-L-L, not A-L.
Okay.
What's the difference, a preacher? A-L means just so. A-L means altogether fine. I'm all right. And we will be all right if we keep trusting in the Lord.
Yes,
sir. When our loved ones go to live with Jesus, we don't need to dwell on the ifs of life. And I want to take the time here because, and I'm sure this family is dealing with this, and I have dealt with it, and some of you have dealt with it. Listen to what Martha said. Martha said, Lord, if thou had been here, my brother would not have died. Martha was talking about Jesus' delay, and she had a list of ifs. I'm sure this family, like all families, has a list of ifs. If I had done more, and so forth. My personal testimony about ifs is, when my father died, he made it known to us that he did not want to die alone. He said, I want somebody with me all the time. And so we tried to provide a way so that somebody would be with him. So he was in the hospital. My mother sat by his bedside. And guess what? When she went to lunch, just for a few minutes, she came back, he had passed. Then the if was, if she had stayed.
Yes.
It's all in God's hand.
Yes.
We have no control over that.
No.
Some of you might say, I wish I had come more often, come home more often. I know you have those if things. I had the same if. I said, maybe if I had been there to relieve my mother, then, but then it wasn't a matter. Don't dwell on you. You're going to have them. You can't have them. Have them.
Right.
I'm not going to tell you not to have them. Don't dwell on them. We have our ifs. And we beat ourselves up with our what? Ifs. When God is in control. Let me just say this. Sometimes there are people that we feel don't deserve to live. We wish they would die. There are other people who die, and we think that they should not have died.
Right.
But we are not in control.
Right.
You know the people you want to, if you could, you'd take them out of here. But you are not what?
Right.
So let's get away from trying to figure God out. Who should do this? Just live and treat people right. I tell you one thing to do, and then you have that would decrease our ifs if we do all we can while we can. Make the best. Listen, family. Some of you haven't seen each other in a minute. I tell you what to do. Make the best of this week, this weekend. Spend time, love on each other, get numbers. Text, do whatever you need to do, and make the best of this weekend, and then let this weekend, where you are here to celebrate your father and grandfather and all passing away, let this be a memory time.
Yes.
Take time with it. That's the problem. Sometimes we don't take enough time when we have time with each other. We're so busy doing nothing. It doesn't really matter. Take time with each other. Love on each other. Don't be afraid to tell each other I love you. And men, I know y'all have trouble. Y'all have trouble that love with you. Get it out. It's all right to say you love somebody. Your family. Do that. And that will decrease. You're going to have some ifs, but that will decrease. Listen to this. Even the Jews, now listen to this. The Jews who were comforting Mary and Martha had their list of ifs. Verse 37 says, some of them said, could not this man which had opened the eyes of the blind, had not called even this man that he should not have died. They even had their gifts. The church had their gifts. If we had done more, let me tell you how to deal with these ills. We must believe that our destiny and end of life is in the hand of God. Amen. I don't do what I do to live longer. I don't know how long I live. I do what I do for a better quality of life. I do what I do at my age for a better quality. Because if I get stuck along the road, I want to be able to walk a mile at least.
Christian and living for Jesus.
Yes.
Because he has promised us if we do that,
I'll go away and I'll prepare a place for you.
Yes.
I will come back again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. He has promised us that. And we have a lot, you know. Jesus gave his life on the cross. And I saw more evidence that the grave and that he gave his life when I was in the Holy Land. I visited the Holy Land two times, and the two times that I visited Jerusalem and places in the Holy Land, one of the places I wanted to go to was the tomb. I wanted to see the tomb where they said Jesus was laid when they were crucified. And I went into that tomb, and each time I went, I did not see Jesus. Because he what?
Rose.
He rose from the dead. And I want to say today is his resurrection gives us hope.
Yes.
That we're going to be resurrected. We're not going to just stay in the grave. He said, and listen, first of all, he took the sting out of death. So that means it can't sting. Don't fear death. Because death has no sting. It's in the scripture. He took the sting out of death. When we were children, we used to play with bumblebees. And my sister Valerie, the oldest girl, was very afraid of insects. You know, we live in the country, so you're not supposed to be afraid in the country of insects, but she was. But I would take the sting out of the bumblebee and then put him on her. Knowing that even though he was on her, he couldn't sting. What I'm saying is that what Jesus had done is that he had taken the sting out of death. So that even though we fear death, he comes big and bad, but guess what? He has no sting. He has no sting. I say he has no sting. You can live with Jesus. And the grave has been holding people forever. But when Jesus went down to the grave and told them to show me where you laid Lazarus. And they took him to the tomb.
Yes.
Excuse me. They took him to the tomb. And they opened the door of the tomb, and everybody wondered what he's going to do. This man been in the tomb for 4 days. And what is he going to do? And Jesus said, looked up to heaven and told the Lord, said, I want you to do it not for my sake, but for the sake of those who are standing around wondering what's going to happen. And he called Lazarus. And when he called him, Lazarus came forth. And guess what? If he had not called him by name, every dead person in that grave would have got up. But he called him by name. And guess what? On the other day, he called Fred's name. Lord have mercy. And said, come on home. And guess what? He knows my name. He knows your name. He knows everybody's name who's on the list. And one day, he's going to call our name. And we're going to get up. Thank you, God. And you know what? Jesus said, when Jesus got up and when Jesus rose from the dead, he said, I got the keys of death and hell. You know why I'm glad that he had the key to hell and didn't give it to us? We know some people what we said. But what he gave us the key to what? Hell. You can get people in hell. Thanks be to God. They give us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We will see Brother Fred Course again. Until then, I say to the family, hang on in.
God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you.
What a powerful word for us on today. Believers never die. A tribute to the grandsons. Someone is missing. Let this be a loving reminder that someone is missing today. Someone our hearts still hold on to as we travel along this way. Someone who's made life so special for all those who gather here. Someone who won't be forgotten, but cherished from year to year. And now as we pause to remember, let us all fondly call how dearly each of us loved him, and oh, how he loved us all. Expressions from the family, our treasured memories of him, are enriched by our loving acts of kindness, which bring comfort and peace in these pensive moments. Thank you for caring and sharing in the life expressions and the homegoing of our beloved Fred L. Morris, Sr. At this time, the mortician's shall come. Due to the inclement weather, we shall have the committal here at the church. For as much as that has pleased the Almighty in his wise providence to take out of this world the soul of our deceased brother, we therefore commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection unto eternal life, through our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose coming in glorious majesty to judge the world, the earth, and the sea shall give up their dead. The corruptible bodies of those who sleep in him shall be changed and made like unto his own glorious body, according to the mighty working whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. The God of peace, the God of grace, continue to bless and keep you. We count it done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Certainly, I would like to take this opportunity to thank each of you for your many acts of kindness and certainly for your presence here today. I would also like to take a few moments to thank Pastor Jackson, to Bishop Williams, and the entire Jerusalem Church family. And lastly, but certainly not least, to the Quartz family, on behalf of the staff of McLaurin Harris Funeral Home, we simply would like to say thank you. Thank you for trusting us and allowing us to share this beautiful homegoing celebration. And at this time, Dr. White is coming with just a small token of appreciation that we would like to present to the family. Know that we love you,
right,
and we will forever keep you in our hearts and in our prayers. Can we give God praise? Just as we prepare for the reception, the family will be receiving you all in the fellowship hall. Those family members that would like to be a part of the interment service are certainly are welcome to follow us. But again, please remain where you are so that we're able to exit in an orderly fashion. Again, thank you all for coming, and may heaven smile upon each and every one of you.